You know, the one word that the Lord Jesus uses to describe the Christian life is the word abundant. As a matter of fact, that's what Jesus said in John chapter 10, verse 10. He said, I've come that you might have life and that you might have it more what? More abundantly. And that word abundant in the Greek New Testament is a word that is really a mathematical term. And it's a term that always denotes that which is of a surplus. And I think what Jesus was saying by using that word was that when we come to Him, trust Him as our personal Savior and Lord, that we have an overabundance of everything that we possibly could ever need to live the victorious Christian life. In other words, He says, I want you to have a life and to live a life that literally is spiritually overflowing. And yet, would you not agree that probably the majority of Christ followers, that kind of life is really theory rather than reality? I mean, it's almost like, you know, we've been given a first-class ticket, and yet we are riding on the back of the plane. Like we have been given keys to a brand new Mercedes, and yet we are riding around in a horse and buggy. It's almost like we've been given this palatial home that we're to live in, and we are dwelling out here in a pup tent. We are just not living up to what Christ said, I want you to experience and you to enjoy as being one of my followers. And I really do believe that the majority of God's people, they spend all of their lives looking for that key that will unlock that door to experiencing abundant living. And I really do think that the key to opening that door is found in the series of messages that we started last Sunday morning. And you remember that I entitled this study, Who Am I? We are looking at who we are in Christ, our identity in Christ. I think that we basically have three needs in life. We have the need to be significant, we have the need to be sufficient, and we have the need to be secure. Every single individual believer has one of these needs. And I think that understanding our identity, who we are in Christ, really is the answer to those three needs that all of us face in life. You know, last Sunday I asked the question, and that question was, who am I? And I answered that question by saying, I am God's child in God's family. Today I want to ask that question again, and I want to answer it by saying, I am accepted. Now, there's a verse of Scripture that every Christian ought to memorize, write on their heart, recite it every day. And it's a verse that's found in where it says that Ephesians chapter 1, verse 6, where it says, to the praise of the glory of His grace, we are accepted in the Beloved. What that means is that when we have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, God accepts us. And I really believe that when we know that we have been, because of our relationship to Christ, accepted by God, then the significant issue and the sufficient issue and the security issue, all of that is settled. There is a poem that was written by an author by the name of Sevilla D. Martin. And in that poem, she writes and says, in the Beloved accepted am I, risen, ascended, and seated on high, saved from all sin through His infinite grace, with the redeemed ones accorded a place. In the Beloved, God's marvelous grace calls me to dwell in this wonderful place. God sees my Savior, and then He sees me in the Beloved, accepted and free. It's the prayer of my heart that when we get finished with the sermon today, that all of us will be able to see ourselves as the poet and also as God does. Who am I? I am accepted. I invite you to open your Bibles with me today to the book of 1 John chapter number 3. 1 John chapter number 3, and I want us to look at the first three verses, because I think that in these three verses we see that how our relationship with Christ meets our need for significance and sufficiency and also security. 1 John chapter 3, beginning with verse number 1. In verse 1, John writes and he says, behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called, that's by God, the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not because it knew him not. The world doesn't understand us, what we're about, what it is that makes us tick, what the motivations of life are, because they don't know the Christ who lives within us. And then verse 2, he says, beloved, now we are the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. Listen, what he's saying is that sometimes we don't look like sons of God. Sometimes we don't act like sons of God. Sometimes we don't think like sons of God. Sometimes we don't feel like sons of God. But he says, but now we are the sons of God. Does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, that we're going to be like him, for we're going to see him as he is. And then every man that has this hope in him purifieth himself even as he is pure. Now think with me for a few moments this morning about this whole idea of the need for significance, the need for sufficiency, and the need for security, and how that it's all found in a relationship with Jesus Christ. First of all, the need for significance. I don't know how long you've been a believer, but if you've been saved for probably 20 years or more, you will know that one of the most popular books ever written was a book that was written over 20 years ago. And it was a book written by Robert S. McGee, who is the founder of Rapha Ministry. And the title of that book was The Search for Significance. I really don't know if any other book has ever outsold that one single book. In fact, that book was so popular that they developed a small group studies and lessons out of that book. And really, churches around the world studied that. It became a study course within the Southern Baptist Convention. And we asked the question, why was that book so popular? I'll tell you why. It is because everybody has the need to feel like they are significant in life. So think with me about two things about that idea of significance. First of all, the search for significance. Now, last Sunday morning, I made a statement, and you need to remember that statement, and it was simply that it's extremely important the way that we perceive ourselves, the way that we see ourselves based on what God says about us is extremely important. I think that we all have this need that at times that we need to be exalted, and yet the Bible says that we need to be exalted without being inflated. We all have the need to be lifted up, but the Bible says we need to be lifted up without being puffed up. You know, the Bible tells us that we are not to think too highly of ourselves, but neither are we to think too lowly of ourselves. There are some who are followers of Christ, and they just simply denigrate themselves, and that's not good. And then there are others who deify themselves, and that's not good either. So we are on this search for significance, and until we understand what it is that gives us significance, we're going to be exalting ourselves and inflating ourselves, lifting ourselves up and being puffed up, and we're going to be in serious trouble. You know, I was thinking this past week as I was thinking over this message I was going to preach today, I don't think that I could identify a handful of people I've ever met that have not struggled at one point in their life with the feeling of insignificance and insecurity. Think about that for a moment. I think that because of how I was raised, that I grew up with that, and really that was one of the controlling factors of my life, I think, that kept me down as a child of God for a lot of years before I really learned how that I could deal with that feeling of being insignificant and insecure. And you know, sometimes those that we love the most are the ones that hurt us the most. It's kind of like this young preacher that took his first church, pastored 25 people, and he was sitting around the dinner table one Sunday after he had preached what he thought to himself was a masterpiece of a sermon. And he asked his wife, he said, dear wife, how many really great preachers do you think there are in the world? And she looked at him and she said, I don't know, but probably there is one less than you think. My, what a letdown. You see, we have this need to feel like we are significant, and yet sometimes those that we know the best and love the most hinder us from ever reaching that. Friend, I want to tell you, God built us for significance. It is impossible to be a child of God and not be significant. God built us for that, but the problem is we're on a search for it, but we're looking for it in all the wrong places. You know, we try to find our significance in prosperity or in power or in position or in prominence. And all of these things are just a dead-end street. They cannot provide us with this need of feeling significant. And you know why they can't provide it? Because significance is an intrinsic need. And therefore, we cannot find that with mere external additions to our life. It's got to be something that happens and goes on, something that we know that is within our heart. And so the Bible tells us that there is a way to feel significant, but it's not by looking for it in the way that the world looks for it. You know, there are so many people that are searching for significance in all the wrong places, and what they don't understand is that, you know what? Not only is that personally detrimental to them, it is detrimental to everyone around them. For example, something I see a lot of time, especially in young families, is that here is a father and a husband, and he neglects his family because all he does is work 24/7. It's work. It's building his career. And he says that, well, I'm doing this to provide for my family, but really he's not doing that to provide for his family. He's doing that to try to get a promotion because he thinks that will feed his ego. And if it feeds his ego, that he will feel significant. But friend, there is no such thing as lasting, real significance that will bring peace to our hearts apart from a relationship to the Lord Jesus Christ. So we think then about the search for significance. And I tell you, verse number one thrills my heart because it tells me the way that it is satisfied. So we've looked at the search. Now think about the satisfying of significance. In verse number one, he writes and he says, behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew not him. Did you know that if this were the only verse in the Bible, this verse would be enough to tell us how significant that we really are? Why is that? Because this verse tells us that we are loved by God in an amazing way. I really am not convinced that every one of God's children believes that and knows that. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. You see, dear friends, when the Bible says that God loves us, it says that he loves us in such a way that we can never fully mentally comprehend it and figure it out. The Bible loves us because it's his nature to love. The Bible says that God loves us because we have this need of being loved by God and knowing that God loves us. You know, and then I'm talking about the primary resource for giving us the significance in life that we need. I'll tell you what it is, found in one little word, L-O-V-E. But friend, it's not just any kind of love, and that's where we make the mistake. Because let me ask you, if a person's out here and they feel insignificant, they're living an inferior life, what would you say is the dominating emotion of their life? It's fear. Fear. And what is the only answer to fear? Well, John tells us later on in this little epistle, he says, perfect love cast out all fear. And you see, human love cannot do that. You know, if you have a wife or a husband or children or parents that love you, you are blessed. But did you know that no matter how good this love might be, that love cannot provide for you the significance in life that you need, because that kind of love is not perfect love. The only one who loves us perfectly is the only one who is perfect, and that is God Almighty himself. Friend, I want to tell you where our significance is anchored to. Our significance is anchored to the infallible Word of God that tells us that we are loved by God in an amazing and incredible way. In fact, did you know that this really is the whole key for Christian living? I know that because down in verse number 3, he says that every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as God is pure. In other words, we will never behave beyond what we believe. And friend, I'll tell you, the greatest need that we have in life right now, are you listening? Say amen. The greatest need that we have is to get into the Word of God and doctrinally find out who we are in Christ. That's the single greatest need of every Christian that I know. Because until we know who we are, we will never behave like the Bible says that we are to behave. Friend, who are we? We are next of kin to the Trinity. We are children of God. We are heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. We are not sinless, but we are blameless because the Bible says that we are clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And therefore, because we are clothed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ, God accepts us based on who we are in Him, our relationship with Him and to Him. So the greatest need that we have is to get into God's Word, find out who that we are. You see, dear friends, secular psychologists today will tell us this. If you feel insignificant, and if you have this inferiority complex that just hounds you morning, noon, and night, secular psychology says, here's the answer. You need to love yourself. If you do not love yourself, you will not feel significant. But now, wait a minute. That is so not true. Did you know that self-love never provides us with significance? I'll tell you what is the only thing that can provide us with significance is knowing that we are loved by someone we esteem. And when we know that we are loved by God, the most esteemed being of the universe, when we truly know that, it's not just a head knowledge, it's something that has gripped our hearts, then all of a sudden we begin to feel significant. Because how in the world could this amazing God that is described in the Bible love me in the way that He loves me? I really don't think that most believers understand how passionately that God really loves us. Friend, I want to give you a verse, and I want you just to make a note of this verse, and you might want to go back and study it later. I wouldn't even believe what is said here were it not for the fact that it's in the Bible. But in John chapter 17 and verse number 23, Jesus is speaking here. This is His great high priestly prayer. And He's praying here to the Father, and He says, I in them, and thou, that's God, in me. I pray that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that thou hast sent me. Now listen to this phrase. And I want the world to know that you, God, have loved them, my children, just as you have loved me. Friend, you ought to just meditate on that for a while. Jesus is saying, here is what I want my people to know. God, you, the omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent Father, you love them just as much, to the same degree, exactly in the same way that you love me. Friend, that would be blasphemy had Jesus not spoken it. Do you understand that's how God loves you? Would you ever question God's love for Jesus? Why would you ever question God's love for you when He says He loves you to the same degree, just as much as, just like He loves his only begotten son. Now, friend, that tells us something, especially when we relate it back to what John is saying in 1 John chapter 3. It tells us, first of all, that this is an undeserved kind of a love, because back in 1 John 3, 1, it says, "Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us." And the word "bestowed" there literally means that God gave this love without reciprocation. God gave this love without looking for anything in return. See, we don't love like that. This kind of love, it's an undeserved love. There is nothing we could ever do that would warrant God loving us like this. You know, when I brought my three children home from the hospital, I loved them even though they could not return that love. I loved them even though they did not deserve that love. There was not one thing one of my children could do to reciprocate that love when they were just a few days or a few weeks old. About all they could do was cry on one end, and you know what they did on the other end. And I just call Karen and say, "Clean your baby up, dear." Now, friend, that when we think about our love for our children, when we first got them home from the hospital, and how that they didn't return that love in any way, you know what that is? That's just a micro picture of the macro love of God. And so many of us live in bondage thinking that I've got to do something to deserve God loving me. Somehow I've got to impress him. There is something I've got to do. And yet the Bible says that God's love is an undeserved love. It also says that it's an unselfish love. I think that's one of the reasons why God's love is so hard to understand, is because it is so unlike our love. All of our love is tainted with selfishness. Every single bit of it. Every time we love someone, listen, we are always looking for something in return. I mean, the very best of our love is tainted with selfishness, but not God's love. When the Bible says God loves, it says God loves, period. And we know that his love is an unselfish love because of what he gave. What did he give? He gave his only begotten son. I think one of the best commentaries on this, or illustrations of this, is found in the book of Ephesians chapter number 3, when the apostle Paul was praying for the believers there in that church at Ephesus. And listen to his prayer for them. He said, "I pray that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, so that you might be rooted and grounded in love." Rooted and grounded. That your life might be controlled by the love of God, knowing that God loves you. He said, "I pray that you will be able to comprehend with all of the saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height of the love of God." He said, "I pray that you might know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge," which tells us that the love of God, if we're going to know about it and know it and experience it, is far beyond what anything we can comprehend in our minds. "I pray that you might know the love of Christ that passes knowledge, that you might be filled with all of the fullness of God." In other words, to be filled with the fullness of God is to experience the abundant life that Jesus talked about in John chapter 10. And the only way to experience the abundant life is to have an awareness and an experience of the love of God in your heart. Why did he say that? I pray that you might know the height and the depth and the breadth and the length of God's love. Because it describes the only place where we can find that kind of love. And that's at the cross of Christ. Because when you go to the height of that cross and you see that brow that is crowned with thorns, you can write up there, that's the height of God's love. And when you go down to the foot of the cross and you see those precious feet that are nailed there, that never walked in sin, you write down there, that's the depth of God's love. And you can go down to the left side of that cross and see that hand that is spiked to that tree. And you can write, that's the breadth of God's love. And you can go to the right hand of the cross and you can look at that hand of omnipotence that created the heavens and the earth that is now dripping with blood. And you can write, that's the length of God's love. Friend, to know the love of God is to see Christ on the cross being crucified for you and for me. That's how God loves us. It's an unselfish love. It's an undeserved love. It's a unique love. Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God. Guess what that little word manner means? It means out of this world. In other words, behold what out of this world kind of love has the Father bestowed upon us. I did a little word study on that and found out that the same words used in Mark chapter 4, verses 29 through 31, where Jesus spoke and calmed the winds and the waves, and the people said, behold, what manner of man is this, that even the winds and waves obey his voice? He's got to be from another world. We've never seen anything like this before. Friend, that's what God's love is like. It's a love that's out of this world. It's a love that we cannot fully comprehend. It's a love that we do not have the necessary vocabulary to articulate the profundity of it in all of its essence. There's never been anything like it. And the wonder of all wonders is that if we have been saved by the grace of God, we have experienced that kind of love. And friend, I want to ask you a question. If you have been the recipient of this kind of an incredible gift from such an indescribable being, how could you ever feel insignificant? If God has done that for you and given that kind of love to you, how could you ever feel like, you know what? I just don't matter. Friend, you do matter. You do matter for this amazing God who has done such an incredible thing. And so we see, number one, the need for significance. What is the answer to it? A love relationship with Jesus Christ. Number two, very quickly, our need for sufficiency. Sufficiency. Now, we have several psychologists that are in our church family. And they would tell you that secular psychology says that all of the human family have three basic needs or three core needs or values, we might say. And those needs are, based on secular psychology, we have the need to belong, we have the need to feel worth, and we have the need to know that we are competent. Now, I'm not against secular psychology. I'm telling you that the discoveries through the discipline of psychology, which is the study of the soul, can assist us in a lot of ways in understanding human behavior. But here's where the problem lies. The problem is not with secular psychology. The problem is with psychotherapy, which has made its way into Christian counseling and sadly has made its way into the church. Now, you need to understand what I'm talking about when I mention psychotherapy, because that is the number one science out here that's trying to help us to get a handle on our human behavior. And what does psychotherapy do? Psychotherapy is basically a science that teaches us that we are to look within ourselves in order to find the answers for our problems. In other words, it teaches basically three things. It teaches self-reliance, self-confidence, and self-esteem. Now go back to those three needs: the need to belong, the need to feel worth, the need to know that we are competent. Psychotherapy looks to its number one resource to meet all of those needs. It looks to self. And friend, that is the exact opposite of what the Bible teaches. The Bible does not teach us to look to self. The Bible teaches us to look to Christ. And to Christ alone. That is what Romans chapter 15 and verse number 18 says. So here on the one hand, humanistic thought is that, man, if you want to feel like you belong, and if you want to feel like you have worth, And if you want to know that you are competent in life, man, you just look to yourself. You are self-reliant. Man, you can do it. You can belong. You can feel worthy. And yet the Word of God says, if you really want to have all of those three needs met, you better look to Jesus. And friend, what I'm saying is that when we understand that because we are in Christ and we have a relationship with Him, that God accepts us, when we understand that we are accepted by God in Christ, it takes care of all of those needs. When we really know that, I'm telling you what we know. We know that we belong. Let me ask you a question. If you could choose anyone in the entire universe to permanently, inseparably belong to forever, whom would you choose that person to be? Would you choose the one who chose you before you chose him? Would it be someone who has planned your present and future for your best good? Would it be someone who gave his son to purchase you? Would it be someone who is wise enough to always know what is best for you? Would it be someone who is committed to accomplishing his best on your behalf? Would it be someone who has infinite resources by which to meet every need you will ever have? Would it be someone who knows you better than you know yourself? Would it be someone who can abundantly, not barely, but abundantly meet every need of your life? Would it be someone who is powerful enough to keep anyone or anything from ever severing your relationship with him? Would it be someone who is right now constructing a dream home that you're going to live in forever and ever and ever? Is that the kind of person that you would choose to belong to permanently forever and ever and ever and ever? Friend, I want to tell you something. If you've been saved by the grace of God, you belong to Him. And if you belong to Him, bless your heart, you belong. It doesn't matter who you do not belong to. When you understand you belong to Him, and He's watching out for you, taking care of you, has your best interest in heart. Friend, I want to tell you, that tells you, man, I belong. And our relationship with Christ, and we understand that we are accepted by God, we know that we truly belong. I tell you what else we know. We know, secondly, that we have worth. That we have worth. You know, the value of something that is for sale. Are you listening? The value of something that is for sale is determined by the cost. You know, let's say that there is a person that is in the market for a new car. What is that new car worth to that buyer? It's worth what he is willing to pay for that new car. Now think about this for just a moment. Did you know that in the New Testament, that the Bible pictures our redemption from the old Roman world of a slave that was being auctioned off, and a bid was offered up for that particular slave? That's where the whole idea of redemption comes from. It's the idea of buying back. And it's the picture of, here is this slave sinner who is on this auction block. And the auctioneer says to God, now what are you willing to bid for him or for her? Now picture yourself before you came to Christ. That is who you are. You are a slave sinner. You are there on that auction block. There is God looking at you. And as God looks at you, what does he see? He sees a hopeless, helpless sinner. He sees someone, as he perceives them, without having anything whatsoever in their life that they could possibly offer up unto him. He sees a person that is by nature and by action a real rebel against spiritual things. He sees someone that has a sign hanging around their neck, and that sign reads, "Purchase as is, no return." And the auctioneer says to God, now what are you willing to bid that will reveal what you believe this person is worth. And God Almighty reaches into the wallet of his heart. He pulls out his wallet and he says, I am willing to offer the best thing that I have. I bid Jesus. I bid Jesus. Now, friend, do you know that's an accurate illustration of how God feels about your worth? If you're here today and you've been saved by the grace of God, and you were to ask me, Pastor, how much am I worth to God? I say it humbly but correctly. You are worth Jesus to God. You're worth his only begotten Son. Friend, I want to tell you what, when I know that and understand that and believe that and receive that and live by that, with all of the humility of my soul, it makes me want to say, man, I'm a VIP in the family of God. I really am worth something. And you see, I grew up on the other side of the tracks. I grew up from a family that was not one of the social elites of our little community. I grew up in abject poverty. I grew up when some of the snobs in our town would look at my family and say, you're not worth anything. Bless your heart, I beg to differ. I have value. I have worth. Because God says, Craig, you were worth Jesus to me. Friend, that makes me want to take 3 or 4 laps around this building right now. There's nothing that will add worth to your life like that. See, we belong. We have worth. And our relationship with Christ is what tells us that. We are competent, and I don't have time to develop that point. Maybe I'll come back to that in a later sermon, but we are competent. And friend, here is what the world tells us. The world tells us if you want to feel competent, what you've got to depend on, you've got to depend upon your strength, your resources, your mental abilities. You've got to basically depend upon yourself. But the Bible says that if we want to live with a feeling of competency in life, here's how we do it. We don't trust in anything we can do. We trust in Christ. Remember the story of Gideon and the Midianites? And the Midianite army was 135,000 soldiers. And Gideon had an army of 32,000 soldiers. And you would look at that and say, man, that's quite a disparaging, you know, difference. There's no way that Gideon could defeat that army with 32,000 soldiers. And yet Gideon had a lot of confidence in his boys. And he said, yeah, I think we can do it. And God said, no, I need to do something here for your life, Gideon, because you are still trusting in yourself. And God narrowed his army down to 300 soldiers and said, now go and fight the battle. And you know what the rest of the story was. Gideon and 300 soldiers, with the assistance of God, defeated those 135,000 soldiers. And God was teaching him a lesson. Gideon, trust in me. Rely upon me. Don't depend upon yourself and what you can do. You see, the Bible says that we can do all things, how? Through Christ. Not through ourselves, not in our own abilities. I think it is so neat that I'm preaching this point right here because this week has been such a taxing week in my life. My only brother that we are extremely close, grew up together. All we had was each other for a while when our parents were divorced, and he's fighting for his life right now in Jacksonville, Florida, in a hospital, just some kind of crazy infection from a cortisone shot that he got. And so I've spent most of my week by his side in Jacksonville, Florida. And those of you who know me well know that I don't like to stand up here to preach when I'm not prepared. Friend, I want to tell you what, I've had little preparation time this week. Very, very little preparation time. And it probably shows in the sermon that I'm preaching this morning. But I tell you, I got on my knees this morning and said, God, you know my heart. I didn't study not because I'm lazy, but Lord, I didn't have time. And God, I'm going to have to believe what I'm preaching this morning. I'm going to have to trust in you, your strength, your resources, your ability. God, you do it through me. And I'm amazed. I've remembered more this morning than usually I do when I study and prepare all week. Pretty good stuff. Maybe I won't ever study again. But friend, what I'm trying to tell you is that we are competent when our trust is in Him. And if you have the living Christ dwelling in your heart and life, you're competent. You can do the job of living the Christian life. Because it's not you who lives it, but it's Christ who lives His life through you. Amen? So we are competent. Let me mention one more thing before I close. The need for significance is met in Jesus. The need for security or sufficiency is met in Jesus. And the need for security, where is it met? In Jesus. You know, I've talked to people over the years and still do talk to them that do not believe that we will ever be secure until we finally get to heaven. But the Bible says in verse number 2, beloved, now we are the sons of God. Not then, but now we are the sons of God. Friend, I want to remind you, if you think that you'll never be secure until you get to heaven, you need to remember about a group of angels that were in heaven that were not secure because they fell from heaven. Friend, our security is not in a place. Our security is in a person. And His name is Jesus. Our security is found in the fact that we are in Christ. That's where our security is. Don't you love that illustration that Simon Peter gives over in his second little epistle there when he takes Noah's Ark and uses it as a typology, as a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ? He says, Jesus is to us what the Ark was to Noah and his family. And Noah and his family, they got into the ark. God shut the door, and they were as secure as long as the ark was secure. They could not go under unless the ark went under. Now, friend, I'll guarantee you that while they were in the ark, and the rain was falling, and the storm was a-brewing, they might have fallen down inside the ark, but they never fell out of the ark. And if you are in Christ, you might stumble, you might fall down from time to time, but you can't fall out of Him because you are as secure as He is secure. And you could not go down unless Jesus went down. You are secure. You know, of all the things that I have said today, there's really one point of emphasis that I want you to leave with. God loves you. 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 God loves me. God loves us. Greatest theological truth of the Bible. God loves us. And you know what? It doesn't matter how scarred your life may be by sin. God still loves you. He sees those scars, and yet He still loves you in spite of those scars. I read a touching story years ago about this little girl. She was severely disfigured. She had been in a fire. Both parents were lost in the fire. And her face was all disfigured. You could barely even recognize her as being a human being. There were no living relatives, and so she was consigned to be sent to a children's home to live while she was growing up. And in the story, it said that when other children saw her, they would laugh at her. That when adults saw her, they were so turned off. She was so hideous to look at that they would just keep their distance from her. No one would have anything to do with this precious little girl that had been so loved by mom and dad, but mom and dad were now gone. The time came when she was to go to that children's home. And she was sent along with a group of other little kids to go and meet the superintendent of that home down at the train station. And the story said that as they gathered there at the train station, the other little kids were huddled up over in a corner playing with one another, and that one little girl was way off to the side, all alone by herself with her head bowed. The superintendent arrived on the scene. He saw the kids over there, and he realized that all of them had come from very bad situations and bad home lives. And so immediately he went to them, started patting them on the head, started hugging them, started planting kisses on them to let them know that they were loved, to let them know that someone cared about them. And all the while, here's this little girl over here. She sees everything that's going on. She is absolutely starved for affection, for somebody to love her. And the story said that she began to inch her way over to where the superintendent and the other little children were gathered. And she got right next to the superintendent, bowed her head, reached up and pulled on his coat. And as he looked down, she said, "Mr. Superintendent, I know that I'm not pretty like the other little children. In fact, I know that I am ugly and am not pretty to look upon at all. And sir, I'm not asking you to kiss my scarred face, but I'm asking you, would you just acknowledge me? Would you just pat me on the back? Would you just let me know somehow that I am loved and I am appreciated?" And you know the rest of the story. He bent down to where she was, put his arms underneath her chin, pulled her face up, looked her directly in the eyes, grabbed her on both sides of her face, pulled her close, and started putting kisses all over that scarred little face. That's the love of God. Friend, I can remember so vividly, October the 31st, 1976, when I heard about this amazing God that loved in such an incredible way. First time I'd heard about that kind of love. And I remember coming to him and saying, "Dear God, my life is so scarred by sin. God, could you love me?" And I'm going to tell you what he did for me, and he'll do for you. He picked me up, and he planted smothering kisses of his sweet grace all over my scarred life. And dear friend, that's what he wants to do for you. I'm telling you, God wants to love you. He wants to love you. He wants you to know that you are loved. How in the world could anyone say no to such an indescribable love? Would you stand, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed, no one looking around. And our God, we thank you for your amazing love. God, we thank you that your word tells us that it is the love of God that leads people to repentance. And I pray that for those who are here today who have never thought about you loving them like has been described today, God, I pray that they would be compelled to come forward and tell one of our ministers, "I want to receive Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I want to experience God's love in my own heart and in my own life." God, I pray that when I say amen, that those who need a Savior will come. I pray for those who are here today, they are Christ followers. And yet, Lord, they don't feel like they're loved. They've been living in that bondage for a long, long time. I pray, God, you would set them free from that today, that they might begin to walk and live in victory. I pray for those who are here today, you've led to become a member of this church. I pray that today they would respond, those that need to follow in believers' baptism. Maybe others who just need to come and get in the altar and rejoice over being loved in such an amazing way. But oh God, I pray that we'd respond appropriately to your revelation this day. In Jesus' name I pray. Heads are bowed, eyes closed, choir singing. We invite you to come.